So here with Peter John White, who's an actor, quite a famous actor, and we'll find out why. You've worked in Hollywood, so we're going to take a step back in time, Peter, a bit, aren't we, for Hollywood?
Yes, and, of course, yeah.
We're going to go back to the Titanic, 1994.
Yes, yeah. Indeed, yeah, yeah. So I was, yeah. I was cast in the Titanic. At the time, I had no idea anything about it whatsoever. I'd been to loads of auditions for it, and they kept calling me back and calling me back, and then one day they called up and said, do you want to go down to Mexico for a couple of days? And I was like, yeah. So a limousine showed up at my house. They drove me down to Los Angeles Airport. They made a special first class bit in a commuter plane. They put a curtain around me so I didn't have to mingle with the public. And then from the airport, I got picked up and driven in a fast car to this hotel. And go into the hotel, and the bar was completely full of English actors. And I was like, oh, I'm here. I'm just going to be here for a couple of days. And everyone started laughing because they'd all been told the same thing and they'd been there for months. So my 2 days' work ended up at 3 months' work, and it was, including a month in Los Angeles on payroll as well.
Yeah.
Absolutely amazing.
Yeah. And so where was that film shot? Because it's an iconic film, Titanic, isn't it? And it kind of launched a career. Kate wins it, but more Leonardo DiCaprio completely launched his career, didn't it?
Absolutely, yes. So it's shot on the Baja Peninsula, which is basically an area of desert land, about 100 miles south of San Diego, 200 miles south of Los Angeles. And they did it there because it's dead flat. And so they built the boat 90% scale out of scaffolding. So when you were like miles away driving down the coast, you'd see the four funnels on the horizon just get bigger and bigger and bigger. It was absolutely remarkable.
Yeah.
And they had like huge amounts of extras all milling around in like period costume and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And they had days where they were going to flip it. So they did everything in reverse. So every sign was backwards. All the car registration plates were backwards. Everything was backwards because they only built one side of the ship. So when they were filming the other side of the ship, they just flipped the negative over.
Yeah.
So just insane things like that. Absolutely astonishing.
Extraordinary. Yeah. What was the budget for that? It was a pretty big budget, wasn't it?
The original budget was something like $100 million, but they went up to $200 million, I think, and over. Because it was really tense for a while because he kept going back and asking for things.
And what was your part in it then?
I played Third Officer Groves on the Californian, which is a part that cannot be cut from the film. It's absolutely crucial to the story of the Titanic. The Californian was a ship that knew about the icebergs, had stopped in the iceberg field, and knew the Titanic was coming, and tried to tell the Titanic, to let them know, we're stopped in icebergs, and the Titanic radio room wouldn't listen to them because they're sending out messages about Lord Astor's wants his blue carriage at port and da-da-da-da. And so they wouldn't listen to the messages. At that time, radio rooms on ships were only open like until 10 o'clock. And so the Californian turned off their radio at 10 o'clock and all went off and did their own things whilst the Titanic sank.
Which was, and how far away was that boat? Because this is the boat that was actually close by, famously close by.
It was probably 5 or 6 miles away. So the Groves...
Yeah.
The character, the real person, could see the Titanic on the horizon and told somebody, oh, look, it looks like that ship's sinking. But in fact, it's just a trick of the light. It's just moving around. So they watched it sink obliviously.
Which is a shame. And that would have kind of saved a lot of lives, wouldn't it? Do we know how big that boat was at that?
They would have been able to radio up for more things. Because there was another ship there, the Carpathia, which was a bit further away. So, yeah, so the 1,000, 1,200 people died.
Yeah.
So they probably could all have been saved if they could have got to the Titanic before it actually sank. So it took ages to sink as well.
Yeah, before we go into your role, did you do a lot of research about the Titanic? Because it still lives long in the memory here, doesn't it? We still talk about it. We use it as a kind of, a way to symbolise disaster.
Yes, exactly. Well, I read up quite a lot about it because it was quite interesting that Third Officer Groves, the guy who was playing, subsequently went on to be a shipwreck investigator, which was like, curious. I guess he felt rather bad about his performance on that night. And he died the year I was born, which is a whole series of like wild coincidences. The ship, the Californian, went on to be sunk in World War I, as indeed the other ship, the Carpathia, which was another one of the ships, also got sunk in World War I.
Yeah. What about your role in? I mean, what was it like? I mean, how much did you film and what was it edited down to? Because this is always the thing, being in the news business, you can talk forever, but it can get cut down to 3 minutes.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So we had two main scenes that we filmed. Where it was the radio room where we were talking about how the Titanic, we're trying to send the message to the Titanic, and they were coming back and saying, keep out, I'm sending a message. And then there was another bit where they were looking at us from behind, looking over the icebergs. So it wasn't much filming. I was there for months because they arranged it that because our scene was so simple and our set was so small they could move it around on a forklift truck, we were going to be a wet weather scene. So if it ever rained in the Baja Peninsula, which it never does, they would come to us. So it never rained. So we were just there for months. They sent me back to Los Angeles on pay, and then I arranged a massive party at my house, and then they called me up and said, we're going to film you in about 5 hours. You need to be here. So they hauled me all the way down. Then they didn't film again.
Yeah.
We ended up filming in the middle of the night. It was like 4 or 5 a.m. when we did all the stuff. And it was a weird sort of like empty set. Linda Hamilton was there because James Cameron was married to Linda Hamilton at the time.
Yeah.
Who was from the Terminator films.
Yeah.
And at the end she was, oh, guys, great, well done. So, yeah, it was just absolutely remarkable. Absolutely insane.
Tell us about the parties then, because you did meet Leonardo DiCaprio and you met James Cameron, the director as well.
Yeah, so we stayed in the same hotel as Leonardo DiCaprio. So we saw him the evenings, the times he wasn't working. He spent most of his time being filmed. But they also had parties down on the beach. And I remember a Thanksgiving party we went where Frances Fisher, who was Clint Eastwood's ex-wife, threw a massive party at her house. And they had free drinks at the hotel, so we stayed at the hotel for a while and then went to the party quite drunk. I banged on the door. Leonardo DiCaprio opened the door and was like, hey, guys, come on in. And so we were just like swanning around, drinking margaritas and stuff. And every so often, somebody would say to me, have you met Jim yet? And I was like, Jim? No, I haven't met Jim. So eventually, I bumped into this guy and somebody said, oh, Pete, this is Jim. Jim, this is Pete. And I was like, oh, Jim, how are you? You know, what are you doing here? And he's like, I'm the director. It was James Cameron.
Yeah.
So ended up having a big chat with him, obviously because I was really sort of nervously embarrassed that I'd completely failed to recognise him. And I think he quite liked me because he hadn't come across anyone quite so gauche or drunk. So I gave him had a long chat and I gave him lots of advice. And I fell asleep when I was talking to him. And he sort of tapped me on the hand and woke me up and he said, you know, you're really crazy. Yeah. And And the next time I saw him was on set.
Exactly, because is the director there throughout the filming process, or does he or she delegate certain scenes, or are they literally there? Because you were saying you filmed something at 5 a.m. in the morning.
They ran their own time schedule.
Right.
So they have these things called night suns, which is these enormous lights that they put up, so they could make night day and stuff like that. But he did the main scenes were all shot with him. There was a second unit and a third unit that did a lot of the flooding and the sort of disaster stuff. They had bits of the ship in tanks that would tilt over and fill up with water and stuff. So they had different units doing that. But he did the main sort of dialogue scenes.
Yeah.
So he actually rewrote. So I've been there for months with my lines and everything like that. And when we showed up on set, he said, I've decided we're going to do it all differently. So he gave us new lines to do.
Yeah,
there and then, which is what happens.
Which probably worked, because that film does live long in the memory, as we said, and it is a brilliant film, isn't it? And, you know, you could still play it at cinemas now. You'd probably get crowds going to it this late stage. Do you think things have changed now, then, with the Hollywood films? Because a lot of it would be digital now, wouldn't it, as well? Yeah. I'm thinking that Titanic, would they actually build that set now, do you think? Or would it be digital?
James Cameron would probably have built most of it. Because it's so much more real. And even now, with the way technology is, if you had a CGI boat, there would be elements that would look wrong. Some of the shots he did, these massive panning shots of these huge cranes, where the thing was like sort of seven stories up and panned down and went into the sort of the dining rooms and stuff like that. So it would be really, really hard to CGI that, especially with the hundreds of actors and stuff they had on set. And so.
Tell us a bit about the big player actors, and they had their own beach villas, didn't they? Apart from Kate Winslet.
Yeah, Kate Winslet, lovely person, but she didn't mix with the ordinary folk. So she had a villa up on the hill. The named actors tended to have fillers on the beach, whereas all the sort of younger, sort of unknown ones all stayed in this golfing hotel with the free bar.
Yeah.
Which was very good. Had many, many interesting... I've met Bernard Fox, who was the wizard in Bewitched. So there was an English wizard in Bewitched. So I met him, and he was absolutely, absolutely brilliant, absolutely hilarious.
Yeah.
So he told me all these long stories about how he was on the stage in the West End, how he missed his cue because he was sitting talking to somebody in the audience, and there's fabulous stuff. He said, I can't drink, but maybe I'll just have a brandy. Yeah. Yes, that was his line.
And was that a kind of a golden era? Because I know that the some of the people you met in LA at that time, they went on to do other things such as write scripts for The Office, well, the American version of The Office, which isn't as good as the English one, of course. So that's it for the first half. Join me for the second half. I'll be speaking a lot more with Peter John White, the actor and comedian, about his time in Hollywood and also what he's been getting up to in the present time. So join us then. So welcome back to The Vote. I am going to be speaking more to Peter John White, the actor and comedian, about his time on the Titanic film set and also a bit more about the people he met there during his time in San Diego, as well as a bit about his initiative with plaques on Brighton Pier, Brighton Palace Pier. So join us for the show. Tell us a bit about that.
Well, so I was, the time I was in Los Angeles, I was involved in improvised comedy. And there's a theatre called the Groundlings Theatre, which brought on lots of people. So when I first joined the Groundlings Theatre, Lisa Kudrow was there. And she was doing some sitcom thing in Los Angeles. And she's got, guys, I'm going. I've got to do this big thing. You know. And then in the group with me was Cheryl Hines, who went on to do Curb Your Enthusiasm. So I worked with so many people. But once I was cut out of the Titanic, it was a massive disappointment. I met this beautiful English woman who was a journalist, and she was moving back to London. So I had this point, so what do I do? So I came back to London, two kids, all great, but the acting things rather dried up. The last thing I did, I was a rabbi in a short film, which is a story in itself.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
I might not share with you.
Yeah, exactly.
I've done lots of adverts as well.
How did you find out that you weren't in the film? Because did they tell you, or did you just have a mass screening, private screening, and then you suddenly realise you're not actually in it?
Yeah, the woman I subsequently married, Victoria, went to the press screening. And she's like, oh, sorry, you're not in it. Yeah, she's a northern. She's northern, very, doesn't spare any. Yeah, she's no, not in it. No. And I was like,
and so you weren't actually told then?
No.
Interesting.
It wasn't. Subsequently, I bumped into James Cameron at the 3D Titanic premiere at the Albert Hall, which I also wasn't in. But I managed to blag my way into the whole thing. And all these people standing around saying, oh, Mr. Cameron, it's all so wonderful. And I sort of leapt in and said, I think it's about 3 minutes short.
Yeah.
He was like, oh, very funny.
Do you know why it wasn't part? Because it's interesting why, because that you were saying that it was quite a key, that character was quite a key part to the Titanic. Yeah. So I wonder why it was cut out.
They filmed 100 and something hours of film.
Yeah, I've heard
which they distilled down to 3 hours, 15 minutes. And so they cut loads of the story out. So if you watch the film, there's no real talk about icebergs or anything like that.
No.
It's going along, everything's very Murray, and suddenly bang.
So with the Titanic scene, the one that was cut, we're going to have a look at that, aren't we? And we can talk a bit more about it as well. Mm. So let's take a look at the Titanic scene.
Excellent. Well, there you can see... as me, reacting to the message that's just been sent in.
Yeah.
The guy I'm working with, Adam Barker, he's Ronnie Barker's son, curiously. We used to play tennis together. And now we're going outside and we're looking at what was a massive green screen, which they subsequently, on the thing, they've just lightly added some icebergs in, but they're not as good as if it had been in the main film. So they did a cheap CGI iceberg there.
Yeah, yeah. And that was quite a key part of the scene, but I wonder why it was cut. I mean, probably because we wanted to see Leonardo DiCaprio and Kate Winslet, and that was basically the film, wasn't it? That relationship, yeah. That's why it's a love film in a way, isn't it?
The film's a love story.
It is.
And it's not a documentary about the Titanic.
At all, no.
Which is a terrible shame for me, I must admit. He filmed 120 hours, which is an enormous amount of film to distill down to 3 hours, 15 minutes. My little bit, if that had been in the film, would have been completely life-changing for me.
Yeah, talk a bit about that, because I often wonder about royalties. You get one-off fee, because I know we spoke about the advertising industry. It's different in the film industry, isn't it? It's much more lucrative.
Yeah, so I was on a Screen Actors Guild contract, which is like a big old deal. And so I got sort of $50,000 or $60,000 just for being there. And they used to give me cash to spend on snacks and drinks and stuff. But the residuals are where you make the really, really big money. So if any part of me had been in the film, I would have made hundreds of thousands of dollars on the video resale thing. So it would have been massive. So a friend of mine, I'm not going to say her name.
Yeah.
She was almost completely cut out of the film. Just the back of her neck and an elbow remained in the film. And she was able to buy a house just off Hollywood Boulevard with the $300,000 residuals that she earned from that.
Extraordinary.
Massive.
So really, if you're an extra in a big film like this, it's big money, and even if you don't say anything, you can just... Or is it not?
The extras are on... It's a different thing. It's a different...
Right.
So the extras, they're like, we'll give you $50 and all you can eat. And that's basically the thing with the extras. The Screen Actors thing is you have a contract. It's a sort of a closed shop union type thing. So the Screen Actors Guild is the sort of NUM of the film industry. So you have to be a member... And you can't be a member unless you're a member, sort of thing. And they have these great residual deals.
Yeah. So the extras are. So what about? Going back to the stories then, with Hollywood. I mean, where do you think it's going now? The Hollywood films. Where's cinema? Do you think post COVID? Are we going to be going back into cinemas, or is it going to be pay on demand? Are they going to issue films on pay on demand before they get to the cinema? This is the big big tension.
People want to go back to cinemas because I've been watching films on the telly for like the last 2 years, and it is just a little miserable, isn't it? It's the thing, you want to go there, you want to get some overpriced popcorn, some like pick and mix. You probably won't be able to pick and mix anymore, will you? But it's the whole experience, you know. It's the big thing, the anticipation, the endless tedious adverts beforehand, you know, noisy people behind you, the tall people come and sit in front of you. It's the experience. You want that. And I can't see my two kids out at the cinema now. You know, they've already been out there.
Yeah.
My youngest went out to see some film last night just because he could.
You know? Yeah. And there's a story about the plaques as well, isn't there? And I know that...
Now this is why I'm here.
Yeah.
I have this business selling brass plaques on Brighton Pier. There's something like 17 million people visit the pier every year. It's massive. You can buy a plaque to put it on the pier where it's going to be seen by everyone. It could be to celebrate. You could have proposed to somebody. It could have been a dog's birthday. It could be anything. It could be a memoriam of somebody like that. If you buy a plaque from deck-squares.co.uk, £50 of the purchase thing will go towards the Rocking Horse Children's Charity or the Imperial Cancer Research Fund. £50 will go to the pier to help them maintain it, and the rest will go to me for the plaque and everything else. So please do that.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. And I mean, is this quite a big thing nowadays, like recognising people in plaques and...
Well, I think so, yeah. A lot of piers do it. It's curious that Brighton Pier don't do it, but you go to like Southwold Pier, it's absolutely covered with the things. It glistens like it's made of brass. So I think it's a great thing. People have so many memories on the pier. You know, I was there today, and there are all these people looking out at sea and, you know, sharing special moments and stuff, and why not celebrate it with a plaque on the pier?
Exactly, yeah. What's that website again for that?
It's deck-squares.co.uk.
Brilliant. And just before we finish up, back to Hollywood then, where do you see, I mean, going to be going in for some more big films or
maybe, me?
Yeah, what? Yeah. I mean, what do you think?
Well, I'd love to. I think what I've got to do now is I've got to wait for most of the people my age to die and thin out the pool a bit, and then I'll be right back at them.
Yeah.
The funny thing is when you're in Los Angeles, there's an air of possibility. So anything can happen. It will just happen. So I was out walking a dog, I bumped into the head of casting for CBS. Now, I live in Eltham now, and there's no chance, of me bumping into anyone from CBS.
Yeah, exactly. So if you're looking to get into the acting career, and when you're older, I mean, how do you join an agency, I guess? And I know we were talking off stage, you end up going to a lot of kind of auditions, which, you know, a bit like job interviews sometimes, isn't it?
Oh, yeah,
which
are
completely pointless.
Exactly,
you know?
Yes.
And you wonder why you do it.
I would suggest that you go and work out. So you do. I like improvisation. Improvisation is the core of a lot of acting skills and things and comedy. Yeah. So go to an improv class and work on your improv skills, and that will lead into something else. Well, it did for me.
Yeah.
So that's what I'd suggest.
Brilliant. All right, we're going to leave it there. Thanks for coming in today.
Thank you.
Again, and all the best for the future. Thank you
very much.
Cheers.
Thank you.
So that's it. We have been hearing from Peter John White, the actor and comedian, about his time on the Titanic film set. Join us again for another episode of The Vote soon.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.